वाई पाटिल इंटरनेशनल यूनिवर्सिटी अकुडी पुणे कैरिंग लेगेसी ऑफ 36 इयर्स ऑफ एजुकेशन एक्सेलेंस फॉलोइंग द फुटस्टेप्स ऑफ पद्मश्री डॉक्टर डी वाई पाटिल अंडर द ग्रेसफुल गाइडेंस ऑफ फाउंडर वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर प्रभात रंजन A nuclear fusion scientist, a futurist. Carve the path to your future career with D.Y. Patil International University, Akurdi, Pune. A new era postgraduate and undergraduate courses, trendsetting multi-track specializations, forward-looking pedagogy, modern infrastructure, well-qualified faculty, state-of-the-art laboratories, and many more. For more details, please visit our website dypiu.ac.in or call us on +91 9071 123434.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to day 4 of our induction ceremony. Myself, Rashmi Darwadkar, I am the host for today's session. The topic for today are cybersecurity and evolving research challenges, which will be presented by Dr. Subramaniam Nilkanthan, and ethical hacking will be presented by Dr. Anup Giridhar. So I would like to welcome Dr. Bahubali, sir. Dr. Bahubali, sir, is the HOD of the Computer Science Department at DYPIU. He currently has more than 18 years of expertise in his field. He also has one patent under him and more than 42 publications. He also has guided 29 projects under him. He is also a member of 5 institutional bodies. I welcome Bahubali sir and would like to say a few words.
Thank you, Rishpiji. Hello everyone. Good evening. Here Dr. Bahubali Shergapur, faculty from BTEC CAC, D.Y. Patil International University at Akurdi, Pune. This program is a part of our induction program. We have scheduled various activities to know our students what are the new happenings in technologies that helps to understand our new cutting edge technologies so that they will come to know what are the new cutting edge technologies. So we have new cutting edge technologies with the multi-track courses under our great visionary leadership, Dr. Prabhat Ranjan sir. So we have in BTEC CSC, there are multiple tracks. First 2 years will be a common for all, and next after 2 years, the tracks are going to change. We have AI, we have data science, we have cybersecurity, we have web technologies, and we have fintech, we have transport intelligence, like that. So we have 10 tracks, and also we have multi-track courses like BC also, Bachelor of Computer Applications, as well as Bioengineering. So we have a new cutting-edge technologies. So this program will help our stakeholders to understand at what level they have to grow. So I welcome you all for the today's session. With us, we have today Dr. Subbu from CIDAC and Dr. Anup Giridhar. So I welcome you all, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Welcome, Dr. Subramaniam Nilkanthan. I would like to introduce you to our today's speaker, Dr. Subramaniam. Dr. Subramaniam is a senior director for Center of Development and Advanced Computing, that is the CIDAC, Corporate Research and Development, Pune. He is the coordinator of R&D activities at CIDAC. He has research in cybersecurity and contribution to software-defined network, network security, and applications of AI for anomaly detection. He has contributed projects related to accessibility standards for India, navigational systems, e-sign, inline digital services, signing services, blockchain, AI for cybersecurity, 5G middleware, SDN, and cybersecurity. He also has contributed immensely towards technology foresight and roadmap reports of CIDAC technology. He has written many technical reports and articles in magazines. He is the chief investigator for various MeitY Government of India funded projects, such as intrusion detection and prevention, dynamic firewalls, insider attack detection, grid security, and unfined threat management projects. He is a research guide to many PhD researchers, M.Tech and B.Tech students. He also offered mentor to startup hackathons. He also has 20 plus international and journal conference publications under him. I welcome Dr. Subramanian Nilkanthan. With this, I would also like to introduce Dr. Anup Giridhar for today's topic, ethical hacking. Dr. Anup Giridhar is the co-founder of Sidelity Solutions and Technologies. He's also a cybersecurity consultant. He is also an editor-in-chief Cyber Times newspaper, editor-in-chief Cyber Times International Journal and Technology and Management, and cyber crime investigator and cybersecurity consultant. He also has total of 18 years of experience. He has multiple books published under him, for example, 8 different blocks of IGNOU on information security, 13 blocks for TMV Pune on cybersecurity for PG level, 3 different semester blocks for TMV Pune on cybersecurity for UG levels. He also has developed study material for various schools and colleges. He also has 1 patent under his name and more than 50 articles published on various technical topics. He has delivered talks on resource person in more than 200 conferences, including national and international. He has conducted more than 500 seminars, workshops, training programs in different government and private institutions, organizations, and law enforcement. I would like to introduce Dr. Anup Giridhar. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks for the introduction.
I would like Dr. Subramanian, sir, to take the dice and present and say a few words.
Namaskar, thank you so much, Mr. Rashmi. So I can, first of all, I would like to extend the sincere thanks for Professor Bahubali and the institution, the Vice Chancellor, everyone, for inviting me for this event. So I can get started with the session. May I request the presentation to be shared now?
Sure, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for that. You can go to the next slide. So what I was thinking for today's talk is that since it's a kind of induction program and you are getting into a key step into your life, it is important for us to understand certain directions in cybersecurity and the research possibilities and various challenges that are there as opportunities more from the research aspects. So we'll go step by step and let's try to understand this particular area. So way back, if you go back to the computing era, so 70s, when it was largely of, mainframes and unconnected, systems, largely this is like huge, big systems that were there. And there used to be, terminals which are getting connected. So even in those days, there used to be attacks largely more from the host security point of view. So where you can see that host-based attacks were there. So these attacks were largely for, the centralized servers that were over there. Slowly, when the advancement of computing happening and networking was also happening in the 80s, the first, it is claimed as the first worm, the birth of the Morey's worm. Incidentally, this is done when happened from a Cornell student. Actually, it is claimed as an exercise not intentionally to do any sabotage, but a program that was targeting certain Unix systems. So those days, it was large Unix operating systems, right? So they were having services like Finger and all these kind of things which were there. That kind of an exploitation was happened. This particular attack is claimed as first worm, and it was also a class of a denial of service attack. So what it used to do is it will consume the entire resources of the system, and slowly the system would lose its capabilities. So this was the first step which opened up the challenge. Now, in the 90s, if you look at it again, newer challenges started coming, like Melissa, the spams, and because email started very commonly being used by many people. So by that time, if you look at the networking architecture, prior to that, it was all proprietary network protocols. When I say proprietary, near systems and networks were connected by IBM or any other individual vendor-specific networks. But in the almost like 90s, you would see a lot of changes towards broadcast-oriented local area network, like Ethernet gave birth. Today, even we are using 802.3 or 11 variant, which is basically the Ethernet kind of a protocol, what you use in your general campus LAN or Wi-Fi, whatever you call, and things like that. So the precursors for all this was happening in 90s. So then what has happened, the inherent weaknesses of these protocols gave birth to various kind of attacks. Like in 2000s, you see a large number of attacks from the internet backbone, like DNS attacks, malware, botnets. This was also becoming a menace where these elements like, you know, cyber warfare and other things were started happening. When you look at 2010 to 15, it is largely, you would see more advanced attacks like, you know, information stealing attack, what you call it as exfiltration. So there are programs that would silently be running in the background and it would be able to transmit outside the data. There are various details, ways of this kind of happens over there. Then advanced persistent threats start coming, which is more concerning and dangerous one in the sense it is very difficult to catch these kind of attacks because they reside and you don't, and they don't operate for some time. And suddenly they spring into action and then they silently carry out the task. So this is very difficult to detect such kind of attacks. But of course, advancement in research is also there, which could kind of profile application of machine learning techniques and things like that are useful to kind of, you know, profile various elements of the system and network to catch such kind of advanced attacks. So presently, when you see this, you see the world is fully connected with devices. Individuals have devices, homes have devices. Even if, soon we'll see that in the roads, you will see a lot of, you know, transportation getting automated, like, you know, smart transportation and things like that will come. So a lot of Internet of Things and IoT devices would come. Already we are seeing some concerns with respect to the IoT security, like, you know, Mirai attacks, variants of it, which targets the IoT attacks that are concerning over the software-defined network, which is basically the programmable network architecture. So nutshell, you see that as and when the advancements are happening in computing and technology, which is also making life easier and getting connected many people and many applications and many sector. Equally on the other side, you also see the concerns growing because the advancement in technology is also opening up for challenges for the researchers over there. I mean, researchers to come up with new ways to solve this problem. May I request to share the next slide, please? Thank you. So typically what you see over here, let us start discussing this. So what you see over here is two nodes, like N1 and N2, right? Let us assume that these two nodes, you can imagine it as a mobile phone, or it could be a laptop, or one could be a laptop and N2 could be a server, or it could be a, N2 could be even a, you know, cloud hosted service or something like that. Now, hypothetically imagine if they are dedicatedly connected, then you don't have any issue because N1 will communicate only to N2. So far, so good. There is no way there are any concern. Where is the concern of cybersecurity coming? Now you look at the next, which is basically the star kind of a figure which is given over here, which is basically the network which is used. So that means N1 communicates through some common or public network, like what you call today internet or any kind of local area network, which is being shared by many other members. Once you get into such a kind of a paradigm, then the question of trust comes into a picture. So we do not know what is happening to my information, what I am actually sending it to N2, or what N2 is sending it to N1. This is the first concern. On adding to the our concern, there are elements like, you know, A1, you can call him as, you know, adversary one or attacker one, whomever you want to call. This need not be humans because these days it's all largely programmed, like, you know, bots or, you know, malicious programs, malwares, and it could be all that. They also play an intermediary role, so you really do not know. Now, the challenge what both N1 and N2 has is that they do not know whatever they are communicating, is it really safely reaching the other person, and is it the same thing what is being communicated? So now you see the last one all becomes red. Slowly what happens, if A1 is very smart enough, he can also go and infect N1. So essentially what happens, the source itself gets infected. So then what happens, you become a channel. So these are the kind of an environmental situation that presently we are in. So on the right hand side, if you see, we talk about, when you talk about the cybersecurity context, you look at end systems, you look at devices. So it could be your mobile phone. Today you use a lot of smart devices for your, wearable devices and things like that for health monitoring and things like that, right? All of them we categorize under in cybersecurity as end system and devices. So how are they securely communicating? Are they secure themselves, right? The second concern comes from the network and the channel. So when you see the network, then as written, you can see that it could be wired channel or it could be wireless. Again, it is not that wired channel is always safe. The reason is that the protocol underneath on top of the wired channel is mostly broadcast protocol. So that means an information that is sent from N1 that essentially only should go to N2 may not necessarily happen inside what is happening in the network elements. It may get stored, it may get, viewed or processed. It is possible, but there are methods, of course, to not do all that. We'll come to that. I'm now talking only about the context at which what we are discussing. Now, the second one, as I said, is more to do with the communication channel. So there are, again, concerns with respect to the communication channel, and there are ways to mitigate that as well. Third thing is about the application. So applications are what, for example, in N1, when you are using your own laptop or something, you may be using a browser. Now, how sure you are that the browser is safe and secure? Maybe while you have installed it, it was safe, but after some usage and you visiting certain sites and certain activities, it might have got, infected. You do not know. So that is where the application comes from, the N1 side. If you look at N2, if N2 happens to be, say, a server or a hosted service like cloud or whatever it is, it could be a web server or it could be an email server or it could be any such kind of application server, database server. So you need to ensure that these applications are always secure and safe, right? So the entire world of cybersecurity, when we talk about it, these can be categorized into these elements of, end systems, communication, and application, largely. Thank you. Go to the next slide, please. Yeah. So now, what are the concerns? Okay. We talked about end system. We talked about communication. We talked about application and concerns that are there. Like, for example, recent, some of the attacks which are listed over there is, Blue Keep attack, which is basically a attack specifically for exploiting a particular operating system and RDP through RDP mechanism. Okay. So where a remote code execution can happen, which is then a control of that entire device would go away from it. Or it could be any kind of malware that are possible. Or it could be, as I said, the IoT devices, when there are going to be, it is expected, huge number of billions of devices are going to be connected by 2025. We need to be gearing up to handle such kind of attacks. Next slide, please. So if you look at the DDoS, again, like as I said, as and when the era of technology is advancing, the technologies, the adversaries are also advancing in the technique. So you look at the distributed denial of service attack, the DDoS attack, which we talked about in the origin, has evolved in multiple avatars. So you have different ways now, more than 25, 26 different ways of doing it. So a distributed denial of service attack is, what is a distributed denial of service attack? So for that, let us understand what is a denial of service attack. So what is denial of service attack? So when I am trying to access, say, a particular web server, if that web server is not available, then as a user, I don't get access to it. Now the question is that that means the web server is being targeted by cybersecurity. It's not necessarily, sometimes it may be down for known reasons we are not talking about. We are talking about reasons which are cybersecurity concerning reason, which is like denial of service attack. So for example, if someone wants to bring down a web server, he may do certain set of activities and steps to run certain things and he will be able to do it. So that is denial of service attack. So that means the availability of the service is not available for its users. When you say distributed denial of service, it's again a compounded problem where the source of attack happens from multiple places, and of course it is anonymous. So it's not also easier to trace back and find out. So this is distributed inherited service attack, and there could be various varieties of such, like, you know, volumetric attack. Volumetric attack is basically by one pumping in huge amount of packet or huge amount of information that particular web service will not be able to cater to the request, and the real user will not be able to get the access, whereas the adversary will bring down the server. So this attack can happen from multiple sources. Protocol attacks could be targeting based on the server itself by injecting certain specific payload, and then it'll, you know, bring it down. Or application layer attack, specific weaknesses in the application can be exploited. So these are all different ways that are there. Similarly, if you look at the communication and the stack, when you talk, the whole world is now running on TCP/IP, and most of the applications run on it. It has become a de facto standard. So obviously, that is also one of the targets for the attackers to come up with new variants of vulnerability. So there are such vulnerabilities, vulnerability 20 and things like that. Now, the last one, what is written over there, is very serious, which is man-in-the-middle attack. So what is a man-in-the-middle attack? Like in the example, what we saw, node 1 and node 2, and then there is a intermediary, which is A1. So he is the man in between. Through man-in-the-middle, would it be possible for this A1 to mimic that he himself is N1 to N2? So that N2 will give all the information, thinking that N1 is the guy who is talking, but unfortunately, he'll be giving it to this middle guy, which is A1. Similarly, he will be able to spoof and then return back some other information to N1, saying that this has come from N2. So such kind of attacks are kind of possible through certain methods, and there are mitigation techniques that are also available for it. Yeah, next slide, please. Okay, now let us kind of try to, what is the goal? What are we talking about? So, okay, we have talked about a lot of concerns. We have talked about end system. We have talked about concerns in end system. We talked about communication. We just got a glimpse about what are all the communication related, concerns, that vulnerabilities that can be there. We have tried to understand applications and what are all the set of concerns that can have from the application side. Now, when you look at what is the goal as a researcher or a professional who wants to defend or, you know, have an edge over the attacker and then have device mechanisms to detect or protect and, deter such incident. So our goal is basically moving, you can see as shown in the arrow, making the N1 green and N2 green, right? So in spite of you knowing that there could be A1, there could be multiple A1, A2, A3, we don't know. Similarly, you may be going through an untrusted channel, but still, would you be able to communicate securely without losing the information, as well as without anyone disturbing the communication in between, is the goal. It also means for N2 to maintain his services, he should be protecting himself from distributed inherited service attack. He should be protecting himself from man in the middle, all these kind of adversaries and things like that. So for example, if you look at N1, so there are certain things that are given over there, which are like, you know, added functions, security functions. These are something like, you know, your police force or, positive forces, which will actually thwart these kind of security concerns. So if you see the N1, you see that on the N1, it along with N1 itself, there are, so N1 is, it could be your mobile phone, or it could be your laptop, as I was saying, or it could be your machine, right? So within that, you need to run certain systems like, you know, antivirus or anti-malware or, yeah, any kind of a virtualization security if you're running any tools for it. So these systems and software would keep monitoring this device, and it would know what is actually happening, good or bad, and accordingly, if there are any bad events that are trying to come in, it will be able to thwart. For example, how does an antivirus work? So that means antivirus should know that virus is trying to disturb the device, so I need to stop it. So how does it know that this is a, when a program is running, how does antivirus know that this is a bad program? So then you need to get into the depth of how antivirus system work. There are different technologies and techniques they adopt to it. One is largely the profiling the behavior of the program execution method, how a good program generally does it. And then largely antiviruses are based on signature. You would have known that people say, I need to patch, I need to update my signatures and things like that. So there are well-known methodologies and techniques, and known attacks can be prevented through such method. Okay, now come to the N2. N2 has to do two things. One is that because N2 is not just a single node, he is going to sit in a big network. So first of all, the network has to be also protected. So that is where the role of the firewall comes into picture. So that means whatever the channel, be it talked about the communication concerns, right? Whatever the network and the communication concerns happening, to protect it, whether the packets are good packet or bad packet, whether this packet can come from the source. For example, assume N2 wants to accept only packets from N1. So a firewall can ensure that no N3 or N4 can reach N2. If N3 or N4 sends a packet to N2, that will get dropped by the firewall, because it knows that the policy will be set that it will not accept anyone except from N1 alone. So such kind of policies can be built and network layer protection can be brought in. It is not only based on IP address based blocking. Technologies have advanced, so you can do deep packet analysis, and content level blocking is also possible. So you may accept N1, but you may still not accept certain kind of contents from N1, right? So those kind of rules also can be added in the firewall. So these are all the things that will protect not only N2, but all other systems or devices that are connected to that network. So that is the role of a firewall over there. Now, when you look at N2, N2 also needs to protect itself, the device. So it would need its own protection mechanism, like what we earlier saw. So what you see is that you need a layered approach, like, because the attack can target the network, or the attack can target the devices, or the attack can target the application. You need to have a layered approach for protection and detection of these attacks as well. So you need to have, not a single solution. Once you put a firewall, you cannot say the network is safe, because it will only prevent certain kind of attacks. You still need antivirus, you still need end system security, you need a unified threat protection with various other elements into it. So you can understand is that cybersecurity, if you look at it, the sources of attacks are, the context is different, and the solution also is also devised for per context. So it could be on the networking context, or it could be on the host context, or it could be on the application context. So, but to have a holistic protection, then you need to have all kind of protection measures in place. Next slide, please. Okay. From the solution side, if you look at it, I'll just take a few minutes to discuss three paradigm of, we have now talked too much about on the attacker side. Now let us come from the solution developer or the police side, basically. Or from, when I say police, it's not real police. I'm talking more from a cybersecurity researcher who would want to solve this problem and how to defend these kind of attacks. So when you look at the detection point of view, first is you need to have a monitoring, effective monitoring, meaning you need to know what is actually happening. For example, in your mobile phone or in your laptop, you should know the list of, when I'm saying you, I'm not meaning you as the user. There should be someone as a program, an intelligent program that should be there inside the device, which would monitor and know that these are the programs usually that are run. And if there are any new programs that are coming, and how is it behaving? Is it using too much of memory? Is it using too much of processor? Or is it trying to do certain things, trying to access certain directories which are not supposed to? All these monitoring mechanisms are required from the host side. When I say host side, that is from the end system side. That alone is not sufficient. So you need to have monitoring mechanism in the network also, because what is happening in the network? Who is sending the packet? Is it only N1 is always committing to N2? Is it N3 and N4 is also keeping on coming? Is N3 and N4 coming only in the night period of time when people are not largely active? So you need to have programs, intelligent programs running to monitor the packets and try to see what is actually happening in the network. Is the link down or not? Is the traffic going up and down when N1 is not communicating to N2? Still, do you see traffic? All this kind of analysis is what we call it as monitoring. Apart from that, you need to also have mechanisms for signature-based and behavior-based detection. These are large concepts, basically, from the perspective of solution, cybersecurity solution. So when you say signature-based detection, that means, like, as the name suggests, there will be certain set of patterns. For example, if you look at the network traffic, if you see certain kind of packet, that means it is done, a research is done by the vulnerability research community, and they would come up with certain strings and say that these are very serious patterns, and if such patterns are found, they will make it as a signature available, right? So they will say, for example, in HTTP, if you are using web browsing and on a server side, you see that these kind of packets are coming. That means this packet, once if it is received by the web server will have a serious issue. It may even be a denial of service attack for the server. So such patterns are already done by scientific researchers, and those attack patterns is what is called as a signature. So you need a mechanism to keep these signatures and then compare with what is happening and try to detect or prevent, like what I said, a firewall will do or a antivirus will do and things like that. Now the question is, signature-based detection inherently has one drawback. It has a plus point as well as it has a drawback. What is the plus point? The plus point is that it will 100% detect the attack and prevent it for all the known attack patterns, right? So that is the good news. Now, what is the bad news? The bad news is that if suddenly a new attack, what we typically call it a zero-day attack, comes into picture, signature-based detection will not know that, because it will only look at the signatures, and then if such pattern is not found, it will assume that it is a good packet and then it will send, and then it will have a problem. So what is the solution for it? That's where the behavior-based detection comes into picture. So behavior-based detection is, this is where today in the context of AI and all your machine learning techniques come into picture, where you will be able to profile and learn that these are the typical kind of traffic patterns, these are the typical kind of programs, and this is the kind of access patterns, and accordingly try to come up with a baseline or an outlier typically. And any deviation to such outlier will be claimed as an anomaly. So basically, anomaly detection systems are built based on behavior-based detection method. Okay. Now, when you look at the protection mechanism, as I said, you can take what kind of protection you can give at a network level. You can drop the packet if it is a bad packet, or you can disconnect the connection if it is a bad connection, or you can avoid the bad sources. You can blacklist, say that these IPs I will not connect because these guys are actually always troubling me. So these are bad guys. So these are all the methods that you can do. So that is what essentially is being done by firewall or UTM or whatever you want to call. Okay, the story doesn't end here for solution, because you need to also have mechanisms for response and recovery. Assume hypothetically in all these cases, still on top of all these things, still newer attacks and varied kind of scenarios come, and you have to be vigilant, and you still, if you have got a sense that there is something wrong going, but still you are not able to make out, then you need to have mechanism to trace and tag. Where is the source? What is it happening? And many times it's very difficult. It's not always very easy to trace and track, because if a lot of anonymization methods people do and then come through that. You need to look at the logs and then see whether the logs have been non-tampered with, and you need to know the entire flow and things like that. You can do a tracing of packets and then try to do the analysis of it. Okay, now another question is that, assume hypothetically the server or system is just hacked or whatever it is, then the immediate thing is that you need to control it, curtail it, and recover the data such that it is the original data without non-tampered data. So this is what is being dealt by the solutions that deal with incident handling and cyber forensics. And next slide, please. Yeah, so, okay, now what are we talking here? What till now, let us just do a recap for our benefit. So we try to understand the context. What are the contexts? N system, N1 and N2. We talked about the communication, where it could be troubled, which could be wired or wireless. Third was, we talked about the advisory, which is a program or a bot or whatever you want to call it. These are the contexts. And we try to understand how you need a layered approach by system strengthening it, as well as network to be strengthening it, and application to protect it. And firewall, UTM, all these devices, how it will use, and all that thing we saw. Now, when you talk about cybersecurity, you cannot miss talking about two important things, what is written over there, identity and authentication and cryptography. Basically, you need to first know, basically, N1 should be convinced in a cyber world that indeed I am talking to N2, right? Similarly, the information that is being sent between N1 to N2 should be non-tampered, or it should not be altered, so that it is gone as original. So the N2 should be convinced that actually this is the information that N1 actually has sent, and I have got it. I should be convinced of that. To do all these things, you need to have the understanding of the cryptography and the authentication protocols that are there and things like that. So there are schemes of mathematical models. So what is cryptography? Cryptography talks in a simple term. It is basically a method that is used to transform the information with a mathematical function, such that only by applying the source key, what one is used, you will be able to get back the information back. So that means if N1 wants to communicate to N2, N1 and N2 should first of all agree upon some secret key that is only known to N1 and N2. If such keys are then known to N1 and N2, then what N1 will do, N1 will use a mathematical function, encryption function, and whatever information before communicated to N2 will be transformed using this key into a ciphertext. So when the ciphertext is traveling into the out of N1, it will be absolutely not possible for any adversary like A1 or the communication channel to understand what it is. They will not be able to read the message. It will not be in plain text. It will be ciphertext. They won't be able to do anything and it will reach N2. Now the N2 should have the same key what the N1 was having, so that he will be able to decrypt. So you'll apply a reverse function of cryptography there, and then he will get back the plain text. He only will get. Now, what is this kind of communication? This is called as a symmetric key method of communication. Where, why it is symmetric? Because you have the same method of communication and decrypting and encrypting, and the key is used. The same key is used. Now, what are the plus point of this? The plus point of this kind of a crypto system is that it's very fast and very efficient. What is the drawback? The drawback is that how does N1 share the secret key without anyone's knowledge to N2? Because if you send that key in this channel, that is, you don't know whether it is again read by someone or not. So usually what they do, they use a different channel, meaning they will not use the same communication channel to transmit the key. It could be through some other channel. So some other channel could be your mobile, message, or some other method through that they will agree upon. Or you need to use a key sharing protocol or distribution mechanism to safely do that. So we will not get into that too much of detail of it. So there are mechanisms to do that. Now, there are another set of cryptographic methods that are much more largely used, which has something called as a public key and a private key, PKI, public key infrastructure. So this actually, you don't need to, both N1 and N2 need not have to share the key. So that's the beauty of this. So the math function over here is so designed that there will be two different keys that will be generated and totally be used by these two people. However, they'll be able to share the information. That's the beauty of the public key crypto system over there. So there in that case, so N1, so there will be two parts of the key what N1 will have. So you will have one part of the key which is called a public key. So the names are just public, so it can be broadcasted in the internet by knowing that no one can decipher his information, because he is also going to use his private key. So he will have two keys. N1 will have two keys with him. One is a public key and a private key. Similarly, N2 will have his own public key and private key. So for example, if N1 has to communicate to N2, essentially what will N1 do? N1 will use his private key, and then he will send the N1 will use the private key, public key of N2, and then he will encrypt and send the data. Why he will use the public key of N2? Because the matching private key is required to decipher it out. That can only be done by N2. So that way this algorithm is pretty stronger. So you, for your present understanding, what you can understand is, beyond the systems and network security, what we saw about N system hacks and all those concerns and things like that, one element of cybersecurity largely deals, which is important, is on the mathematical principles of cryptography, which has symmetric key systems, asymmetric key systems, or public key systems. And there are a lot of research happening in further variants of, there are something today, in the last few, I would say more than 7-8 years, the mechanism of something called as homomorphic encryption is gaining more traction in the research world, which essentially is a different trajectory. Basically, that is going to allow people to even mine information which are already ciphered text, not for getting the data back, but to understand certain meaning. So similarly, when you talk about the quantum computing paradigm, there are certain threats that are foreseen for these kind of crypto system, which are integer based mathematical functions, which are very possible for the quantum computers to challenge it. So there are post-quantum cryptography, which is a new area of research that is being dealt with, quantum resistant cryptography, all these things are there. Okay, this is just to give you a glimpse that apart from the system and network security, there are authentication protocols, identity concerns, and cryptographic elements that are important. One more thing which I will say, and then after that we'll go to the next slide, is something about the hashing. See, the integrity of an image, integrity of a message that N1 will send to N2 should be intact, is ensured by another mathematical function, which is hash function. So by that it will do it. Yeah, let's go to the next slide. Yeah, so now I think we have gone into the basics of it. Let me get into the context of what the present trend is all about. You see Internet of Things, as I said, by 2025, it is estimated about 75 billion network devices are going to be there. It's just mind-boggling, and you don't know how these devices are going to be authenticated, how these devices are going to be controlled, how are they going to be monitored, what kind of attacks are going to come against them. We really do not know. So we need to look at it closely and devise newer methods. Penetration of smart cities and getting all elements of utilities getting connected to the homes and public spaces are actually happening. So we need to have be vigilant and solutions to be built over there. V2X, vehicle to infrastructure and vehicle to vehicle, is another paradigm where, you know, all the cars will start communicating to themselves or the vehicle to vehicle and vehicle to the, you know, traffic signal. For example, when a vehicle is going, for example, there could be an emergency vehicle like an ambulance. When it is going, it should have a sensor which will be talking to the you know, traffic controller, and automatically it should get a green wave. All those things are possible today with V2I, vehicle to infrastructure primitive. Now, then imagine a situation of cybersecurity concern in such a paradigm of such mission, when a life critical thing is going to happen. So these are things we need to think aloud. Then we also see a lot of us start, even in the situation present, the pandemic situation, we start, you know, all of us are using many kind of devices and things like that. So, you know, this is kind of growing over there. Next slide, please. So what you are seeing, what I said, is from the sector side. Now, if you look at the computing infrastructure side, again, it is all high performance computing connected with high speed connection, and then it's all becoming dynamic now, right? Please, next slide. Yeah, so what is happening is typically we are moving from a static infrastructure to a dynamic infrastructure. So your compute resources are getting, so those days, like, you know, 10, 15 years before, if you look at it, when I say a server, you know the IP, public IP, and you will tie to it, and it is always that. But today in a cloud, you don't know. There could be multiple processes, and load balancing happens, and there's a lot of, you know, dynamism that happens from the application side, from the communication side. Because when I say communication side, for example, I can today say that give only, say, 2 Mbps of communication traffic to a particular application. And when a VC session like this is happening, dedicated, ensure that this much of bandwidth is available with latencies, less latencies. All those is possible with the dynamic environment today. Yeah, next. So these are all the advantages in the evolving scenario. So it's not only connected to communication devices, you get storage, you power elements getting connected, cooling, everything is all controllable today through the network. Yeah, next. So what we are talking is, see, you know, Internet of Things, you know, IoT sensors, there are gateways, then there are high performance servers getting connected, and then 5G is coming at, you know, so, you know, you see a lot of things that are coming into the digital digitization world, and you need to carefully see how we tackle cybersecurity in each of these elements over there. Yeah, next. Okay, so what this means is that as and when you keep adding components to your context, so we started with only three primary contexts, the devices, the communication, and the application. Now you see the gamut of things that is getting spread now. So it, the moment the sensors and devices come, the moment virtualization, edge, all these things come, you are having a larger landscape. So that means you have a threat vector space is actually wide, right? So that's a concern there. Yeah, next. So this is a slide which is just trying to say that the dynamic situation is actually going to pose more challenges for cybersecurity. But the good news is that obviously there are interesting advancements on the technologies like, you know, AI and you know, learning mechanisms which we can largely adopt and then try to improvise this thing. Yeah, next slide, please. Okay. I'll just spend just 2 minutes because this is an important slide. Only some of the research areas I could you know, ponder over here. As I was saying, the AI and cybersecurity is a key area because there are two ways: AI for cybersecurity and cybersecurity for AI. It is both give and take. It's both a challenge. Meaning, you should be how are the learning machine learning algorithms going to be so advanced such that, for example, I don't want to even put a firewall rule. It should be able to, when I get my laptop, there should be an intelligent program running. It itself, after running for half an hour or 1 hour, it should know that these are bad traffic and that these are good traffic. Is it possible to learn automatically? How is it possible? So those are all the challenges that are being addressed in AI in cybersecurity. Similarly, how do I profile the anomalies, which are good? I mean, this happens to be good, and this definitely, I don't know. Even if it is not bad, but I don't know. Can we say such kind of thing? So that is what is dealing with. Another problem is also like AI is also going to be helping the adversaries as well. They also can use AI techniques to create different variants of various vulnerabilities. So one has to see how we see this interesting challenge. Then comes the situational context-aware approaches, meaning, see, your accuracy of an attack is going to be true only if you understand the context and the situation. So more and more, it is going to be more advanced systems which are going to be situational and context-aware systems. Similarly, authentication. It's gone out those days only with single-factor authentication. So when you see all our banking situation in India, we have multi-factor authentication, right? So it's not just only in login and password. You have OTP or you have other mechanisms, biometric and various other mechanisms for multi-factor authentication. And a lot of face detection, video KYC is being announced recently by RBI. Some of the banks have already started giving it. So these are all the advancement that is happening from the solution side also. So authentication is becoming very stronger. And of course, there are challenges. As I said, it's like catch and, it's always both ways true. So there are quite a lot of advancement and interesting problem statement that are to be addressed. Cryptography, I already talked about it. IoT security. So when you talk about these small footprint devices, right, these devices don't have huge compute power, even like what you have in your mobile phone or in your laptop, obviously. So these are small footprint devices. How will you secure it? How can you run a crypto algorithm in it? Because a crypto algorithm or any mathematical function will be compute intensive, but it doesn't have compute or it doesn't have such huge memory or power because it will lose power, right? So when you have a, say, typical use case like a water monitoring sensor, which is kept there for level monitoring of water in a water tank, right? That will be a small, very cost-effective, very small piece of device. You cannot load too much of things in it. So those are all the things. Edge security, programmable security is another one. Forensics, I said about it, advanced forensics, vehicular forensics, and things like that. Blockchain technology, you would have been hearing about this a lot, because this is the technology which ensures trustworthy transactions to ensure that no one will be able to say that, this transaction I have not done. So that is what this talks about. Hardware and firmware security. How sure that the firmware and the hardware, what is given to us, is actually doing what it has done. Vulnerability research. So from the R&D perspective, and privacy enabled technology. So these are all the key areas of research over there. Yeah, next slide. So I would stop over here. These are some of the key references. And next slide, please. I would like to throw open certain, this is my email ID for any communication. You can reach me, subbu@cdac.in. Yeah, thank you. Next slide. I just opened to the panel that probably we can discuss something on the AI for cybersecurity and how are we going to see the newer challenges and approaches for various sectors like smart cities, finance, health, and infrastructure. Yeah, with this, I conclude my talk. Thank you for the opportunity provided. Thank you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. With this, I would like to invite Dr. Anoop sir to say a few words.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Wonderful presentation, Subbu sir. It was really great to hear from you. And you, within very short span of time, I think you enlightened lots of points. Wonderfully explained, I would say. See, cybersecurity, if we all are working in the terms of security, itself is a very, very vast domain. No doubt in it, like we have lots of challenges, lots of opportunities. And even especially for the youngsters like BTech students and all, like Bahubali sir, as you are saying, you are offering lots of courses. In the similar way, these are the real challenges which are actually has to be more focused oriented. So the trainings and the part, like especially if you talk about in terms of security. So security is not a part like the day you immediately enter and you will simply grab. However, I think on YouTube or many other online channels, if you will just explore, you'll find lots of ample of videos and ample of things where you feel that, oh, come on, let me learn two videos and I have become a hacker. So please try and understand, we do not want to be a hacker. But yes, security is a major challenge. First, you have to understand what exactly the technical part is going on. The day you are understood, you'll be able to confirm that, yes, your system is quite secure. However, it is, again, it's a challenging part that you will not be easily able to say that your system is secure or not. However, if you'll follow a few basic points, I think first, I always suggest that because precaution is always a better countermeasure as compared to any type of security. And generally, whenever I'll start my sessions, I always say, hey, stop using it or take precautions. Because if you are not aware what actually you people are doing, where you are involved into, then really stop using it. So if you're using free email ID like Gmail or Yahoo or Rediff, either stop using it or take precaution because you're not aware what exactly you are doing. Even recently, I was there in one of the case where the collision was like how you claim that the email ID like @Gmail, which you are using, and you have already connected that same email ID with your banking system, with your other system, right? And even your Aadhaar card or other entities. So you actually connect your Gmail system with other, your own identities or other financial entities. So please try and understand, actually you do not have the ownership of that email ID. So where you have the ownership is actually with the Google, with the Gmail. And who are you? So you are you a owner of that email ID? Because you have a password and let's say that password get compromised by someone. So do you really believe that we can able to access the same? And if I'll claim that now this is my email ID, so how you're sure who signed it? There's no KYC behind that. So lots of challenges, lots of technical and legal challenges. Actually in India, what is required, and especially for all the youngsters, like if they are connected in this, especially in this room, I prefer to them, you start thinking from the technology from a very, very close point of view. What exactly is important, why it is important, and is it really worth to use or not? Recently, sir, as you said very correctly about the malware detection techniques and all, one of my scholars' PhD thesis has already been approved and it is already available on Shodh Ganga. You can identify. So we actually created a behavior analysis model and again, the technical model where we actually designed a complete model so that we can, and now we are implementing that model to many servers, where we are analyzing the behavior of each and every packet in the networks. So come on, now network doesn't mean a simple communication. You have to actually learn a lot of depth that what are the protocols, how the protocol performs, what are their ingredients in the protocols. Means I'm talking about all the parametric checks of the protocols. Can you able to pass the values in the protocols? Can you able to access the values of the protocols? And in case if we can manipulate. So manipulating is again somewhere in kind of concept of hacking. And if we can able to capture those packets, if we can hold those packets for a certain period, we can go for a man in the middle attack. In the same pattern, we are also doing a performance analysis or intrusion detection system. So tools, tricks, techniques are almost same, but their purpose, their intention, with ethics or without ethics, the concept is different. I hope you all are using like Truecaller and many other apps. Please really stop using it if you are not knowing what we are doing. Have you ever thought how Truecaller works? So I'm just giving some examples, sir. As a Subbu sir, I already explained you the complete technology. I'm just giving you basic examples. The example like today we have a concept like we all are talking about, we have a Truecaller. What is the purpose of it? It is one of the small software, which is first of all free of cost. So please remember, nothing is free in India or even throughout the globe. Nothing is free. We have to pay a lot and you are not aware what actually you are paying for it. And remember, each and every company is now greedy about data. So the purpose of all the companies are, they want to sustain, they have to reside in your devices, in your digital devices. And the day they'll able to enter it, that's it. And further, they'll start not only a one-time hacking, but real-time hacking is going on. Real-time information, they'll grab our information. It could be either a Facebook, it could be your any social media site, it could be a mobile apps, which you are into using in a frequent way. Even, why not Google? I'll give you a very simple example. Just go and type on Google. Just there is a keyword called Google history, or otherwise you will see my activities on Google. You can't imagine, we can able, or even you'll like explore and you will shock to see what all the activities being performed by you in the previous days, all the timelines along with the timeline, along with the videos which you have watched, everything has already been monitored by the Google. So there is a surveillance and monitoring and other activities has already been there on us. Somewhere some stalking is going on. Please take precaution, because precaution is the best countermeasure. I prefer, if you're not able to stop the computers, are you really ready to go to the back old mobile phones where you only can able to call or SMS? No, I think you are going to go for a smartphone. I prefer. Instead of working on a smartphone, now if you can carry one phone, then being a non-technical, I'm giving you a non-technical example. However, technical things are many, many more things are there. Giving a non-technical example, instead of carrying now one smartphone, I prefer you carry two phones, right? Two smartphones and categorize your computing, your mobile computing, at least your sensitive data, your banking details should be kept on one of the machine, one of the mobile, which is least connected on internet, right? A part of that, whatever you are doing, social media, WhatsApp, Facebook, and all other stuff, I think you keep that part separately. So that at least you should not become a victim of, say, a mobile or your financial frauds or something. Even your like Truecaller, which used to only accept your calls, why they are now accessing your cameras, why they're accessing your geographical location and other parameters, even your SMS. So as Sir very correctly said, like we have now, even in financial sector, we have a 3D model of the technology. In US still there is 2D. In India, we have 3D model for the security purpose. So yeah. Once you have a username password authentication for the transaction, even a part of that, then you will get an OTP. But now another problem is that OTP is, let's say, valid for 30 seconds or for a 1 minute, depending upon the service provider. That OTP is also being accessed by Truecaller or many third-party apps. So hardly matters what you are doing. You are actually hacked. We all are acting like zombies. That is the biggest problem in India. And we all are unaware and we are, you know, ignoring the problems and ignoring the security part. And frequently we are accessing the internet like anything. So stop using it or take precautions. That is the most important part, I think, which you have to understand. And then you have to start working on the computers or on your digital gadgets and so on, right? Many things I think we have to go for, but I think there is a short of time. Some other time we'll have another discussion and we'll give you more examples and all. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. And again, I'll back to the panel for the panel discussion. Please feel free in case if you have any queries. I think Subbu sir and me both are there, and other eminent speakers are also there from from your side. So either way, please, DY Patil International University from there, Rashmi ji and Dr. Bhaubali sir is already there. I really thank you to all and giving us an opportunity to discuss. I think back to you, ma'am, for the panel discussion.
Thank you, sir. So the first question to you, Hanum sir. So how do we protect our banking information? Because we get our OTP on our mails and on the phones. So phones, we can do something. We can block the Truecaller. But what in case of Gmail? The OTP goes also to our Gmail account. So how can we protect that data?
See, that is, again, the irony, I would say, for ourselves, that we officially share our Gmail IDs even to the banks, to the officially. Why you are giving? I prefer, it's better. Means, we all are technology-based people. Why don't we start and we'll take an initiative? Already Government of India has already initiated and they are promoting. Why don't you make in India projects? Come along with your make in India projects. Even I prefer to DY Patil University people, come and let us make a one email server. Let us take a one domain name and let us have a one email server, and let all my students and all my faculties have a one internal email server. And let us maintain also with all the security and all the challenges and all. So in case if you dedicate few of the students and your faculty would be there, they'll get a live project. They'll actually secure the data, and actually your data is under control. It is not then only with the Google. So I always prefer, means otherwise you can go and purchase one domain name, and then you have an extra security feature. Means in case even your password get compromised, you have a control panel, go to your control panel, and even you can change the password from that particular part. So you have a complete control with you. However, the data which you are sharing, I recommend only, means you have to, that basic settings which you have to check. But I think for that, depending upon, is it for the current account or for the saving accounts. So according to those settings and according to the packages, even the banking are also providing you like that. I prefer, instead of using the transactional part, it's better now you carry two, means again, non-technical solution. For again, non-technical people, instead of carrying one saving account, it's better now you carry two saving accounts. One of the saving account, which is least connected or even never connected to internet services. Don't purchase their internet services. Take a one checkbook monthly and you keep all your savings over there. Take one small, another saving account, which has very least a transactional amount. I think you know what is your daily budget or your monthly budget. Accordingly, you just keep that much of amount monthly over there in that particular part, and then do Swiggy, then do Ola Cab, and use wherever you are going to make it. Because in case, however, it is more secure, and there is no such case in terms of that Google hack, however they access, but they use for their data mining, they use for their business intelligence purpose. It is not for the for generating any malified or any other intention to hack someone's password or so. Okay. And again, Google is now connected in India. They have their own Aadhaar, means their Udyog Aadhaar card in India. So they are now interested, and government of India have a complete control on these companies as well. However, it is a funded company. We can't do anything at this point of time. Right. So another way for the end user, they should keep two accounts. One account where it is used for the daily use or whatever the internet services they are offering, carrying least amount, and always be secure about it. Do not share their mobile phone or digital gadgets to others, even to your family members, because you have some intentional, some content, some financial content or confidential data which comes to your phones, or in even in your mobile phones or in your email IDs also, as you said very correctly. So yes, as because we shared, we can't do anything. But otherwise, you purchase, so you have to plan it. You start from the email server side, make your own server, make your own email IDs, personal domains, and even you can work on that. Means, frankly speaking, in my office, if you want to see it on the back end, I have my own web server, I have my own email servers and all other servers. Luckily, we are the India's only company. We filed the patent in the operating system in 2011. So we, sir, as your CDAC is working on BOSS operating system. So we already worked on that, and the name of the software is a Sedulity operating system, and we filed patent long back. And whatever the vulnerabilities and all, we know all the things and all, because it's been more than two decades. We are onto that. So security is there. We need to understand what is that security all about. We need to understand the quantum of the nature of the job which you are doing. Accordingly, the data traffic is there. Accordingly, the massive information which is moving. Then accordingly, we have to decide which level of security is important for which particular task. Okay, accordingly, that all has to be managed. So there is no direct answer for your question that you have to go and simply stop using it. So either I'll say stop using it or take precautions.
Okay, sir. The next question is for Subbu, sir. Sir, yeah. There were multiple ransomware attacks this year. I guess it was on Yahoo and Cognizant and all. So even though they being a huge IT giants, how was it easy for the attackers to get into their security levels and have a ransomware attack?
See, that's what I was trying to say. See, these things, as Dr. Anoop was mentioning, you can go for a layered way of protection. Okay. But as I was saying, as you know, the kind of attack and advancement of technology is also giving space for novel ways of newer attacks coming. So since 2015 onwards, you see a class of attacks that comes on the advanced persistent threat. So these kind of threats are very difficult even for security giants to handle it, because the manner in which they operate, you cannot, very difficult to profile them even in behavior detection. So for example, they are silent. So behavior-based detection works in a way that you have a learning mechanism. So I was talking about the signature-based detection and anomaly-based detection thing, right? So signature-based detection anyway will not be capable of detecting such kind of attack. Anomaly detection, and like what Dr. Anoop was saying, that is the only method now to move for advanced attack detection. But it is not very easy, because what happens, your outliers and your scores, what you said, to detect which is good and which is bad is very difficult. Because if you set the threshold very low, then what will happen? You will have a large number of false alarms. You will miss, or you will miss the attacks, basically. So it's a challenge. But I think what could probably happen is we need to also bring in newer ways of ensuring that, see, that's what, when we talk about cybersecurity, all of us not only talk about always detection and prevention, we always talk about recovery, and we also talk about deterring techniques, basically. So, you know, you need to at least, how soon you are back into business, what is your downtime, how available you are getting into back into business. So that's the way to go about it. But of course, as Dr. Anoop was saying, I absolutely agree with him on the context that we need to have more advanced system, and you need to, it's a race that we we have to face this. Yeah.
Okay. So now an interesting question actually. So nowadays our students are fascinated by the word hacking. So everybody wants to become a white hacker. So how should they not cross the limit? Because while hacking, they have a lot of data in front of them, the bank data or multiple data. So they, how to control that aspiration by the students and not get into black, you know, that hacking part?
Okay, shall I answer?
I think you should answer. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Okay. Ma'am, frankly speaking, see, this hacker word means if you really explore, you'll understand this hacker word is actually came from English US. You know, in English UK, very decent words are there. But this hacker word actually come from English US, little harsh, little, you know, hanky-panky kind of language sort of. So hacker means now they are working, they're wearing white hat, gray hat, black hats and all that stuff. And they're trying to categorize themselves with their way of behavior, their activities or being performed by them. However, this is just for the cities, I would say. The technical part is, and if I say in terms of legal terms, in India, any type of hacking, any type of activity where you are trying to penetrate someone's without their permission is actually an attempt to hack. And then we are not talking about only black hat. Black hat means even there is a provision in our cyber law that you will be considered, in case if you will consider as a cyber terrorist, that you are going to deface the websites of any other countries and all, then there is an imprisonment to the life. So you need to be, I think, what all the difference to, if you really want to generate the difference, I think they should go through with the basic sections of IT Act Amendment 2008. And those sections are Section 43, Section 65, 66, 67. So at least they'll be aware of what is hacking all about according to the nature of the law. Second, ethics. Do you really want to disturb someone? Disturbing to be anyway, in any form, in any manner. If you're disturbing someone, even though it is already there, the concept is there, that if I'll simply, like a student, like a guy, they have a very, you know, very traditional form or very, very, you know, open-ended form. So even without the permission of my friend, if I access their mobile phone, and even if it is, say, password protected or so, and again, even I'm trying to access that particular part, actually, they commit a crime. Please try and understand. Though it is, it's my friend's phone. Why don't I access? I can access. So please try and understand, we are not supposed to access even that, because there is a privacy breach. There is a concept of hacking and the sections are applicable. That's what I said, 43 and section 66, subsection of 66, A, B, C, D, E, F. You need to just to go through and you'll be understand the penalties even up to 1 crore rupee, or even for the corporate level to hire a commissioner, then the penalty may extend up to 5 crore rupees. So there's a provision already in the law. So according to the law, legal perspective, there is nothing hacking, ethical hacking, nothing like that. No cracker, no, all are hackers for them. Because if any person who become an accused and they committed or they identified, so I'm talking, that's why I'm using word accused. If any person whomsoever identified as an accused, they have to show their bona fide, they have to show whether it is being done intentionally or unintentionally. And even if it is intentionally, then there is a criminal breach of trust. And if it is unintentionally, then might be they have to face a penalties and they'll be get blacklisted into that. So students, I think they'll get fascinated to get into the hacking. I want to learn. I want to do this, do that. And even you talk about that. Today we have a session for ethical hacking. The first question you will find out, hey, mera email ID hack karoge kya? So that's a general question which you'll face. Please try and understand. Now we have to make our rules. I think that is a very important and another topic which is very important. Cyber citizenship. We have to talk on that particular part. What is a cyber citizenship? What are our duties? What are our responsibilities to perform on internet? If we are the member in internet world, in the cyber world, we must be aware of what all the precautions, what all the activities need to be performed by us. And in case if somebody is doing any discrepancies, can you capture the digital evidence of that? I have seen nowadays, like, I don't know what happened to the English, especially to the youngsters, LOL, TYSM, I don't know what type of abbreviation they have started now. It is not at all in the dictionary, but they have a special meanings of their words. Right. So please try and understand, might be it actually hurts to somebody's sentiments, somebody's religion, somebody's other impact. So today, like if you're talking to some Gujarati bhai and you will say mota bhai, so mota bhai means you're talking about, hey, big brother. Man, if you're talking the same in the North India and you're saying mota bhai, so like something else. So please try and understand the words. We have to be very carefully while writing. And the moment you place any particular content on your WhatsApp or on any message or anywhere, and in case if somebody hurt by their sentiments due to any way or any mean, that creates a problem for someone. And because it is a digital evidence, you cannot say no. I've seen most verbal, like verbally, we somebody used to talk in abusive language. Hey, hi. And then the slangs already have some abusive language. And I found like they don't mean to speak abusive, but they're still speaking. Very, very, I'm telling you, it's a bad habits. We have to improve that bad habits and we have to come back, because now the same habits, if you're following on your WhatsApp or on your Facebook, you will be behind the bars. So there is a provision, and we placed some posters also long back, but with some universities, you know, one dirty SMS equals to 3 years jail. So I think that kind of information has to be placed to the students. At least they should be aware of that, what they are doing and how they are doing. So nothing is hacking. Nothing is, cracking. These all are the ways or the terms which has been expressed according to their behavior. White hat means you are into the security cops. Black hat means you are into the terrorism side. You want to hijack someone and so. And even gray hat is one of the another very, very more popular, you know, group where the person who are working for their own benefits, either for name, fame, money, or whatever, right? So it is not the matter that they are hacking or so. I think if they are 18 plus, they are liable under IPC, they are liable under IT Act and all other Indian acts. So accordingly, they'll be liable and penalized for that. Take precaution, because that is the most important part. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. With this, I come an end to my questions. Over to you, Bahubali sir, if you want to ask any questions.
No, I think we are running with the time, but it was a very wonderful session. We can have such sessions for our students. So, Dr. Subbal sir and Anup sir, we have, our both of our programs are, I would like to tell you, those are designed in such a way that those are powered by AI, most of our programs. You talk about BCA, we have two tracks. We have cloud as well as we have mobile web applications. And when these are the two tracks. Those are all powered by AI. And when you come to BTech, we have AI and data science, cybersecurity, IoT. You are rightly pointed out IoT, wherein, in coming days, 25 billions of devices are going to come, 26 billions. So as per the NASCOM reports, definitely the security is a very important aspect. So we have started grooming our young minds. So whatever you have thrown to challenges, definitely they have taken into a right point and they will take into a right direction to improve their skill set. So on behalf of our D.Y. Patil International University and our beloved Honorable VC Sir, Dr. Prabhat Ranjan Sir, so I am very much thankful to you for sparing your time and guiding our students and the faculty. And also I would like to thank our students for taking admissions at our D.Y. Patil International University, and also believing us, and we are here to deliver you the best. Thank you, sir. Over to you, Rashmi Madam. Yeah.
Yes.
Pleasure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.